Welcome to our presentation about using role-play games for reflecting upon language documentation. I'm presenting from Gubbi Gubbi Country, Sunshine Coast, Australia. Kathrin is on Yugara and Turrbal Country in Meanjin, Brisbane, Australia. We recognise elders past, present and emerging from the countries where we are presenting. I'm Ben. I'm interested in language technologies. I'm currently project manager with the Transcription Acceleration Project at the Centre of Excellence for the Dynamics of Language, based at the University of Queensland.
Hi, I'm Kathrin, and I'm all for project-based and game-based learning. I'm currently doing a PhD at the University of Queensland to look into how co-designing story-based language adventures together with learners can support learning endangered languages.
Kathrin, how about we start with the burning question?
What's that?
What's a role-play game?
Well, it's a game that a group of people play in which you pretend to be someone else in some fictional setting.
But what's that got to do with language documentation?
As well as being a fun thing to do, it turns out that playing role-playing games or RPGs is a really good way to develop skills in negotiation and creative thinking. And it is a way to reflect upon things.
That's what we thought anyway. Let's see how it went. We wanted to reflect upon established ways of doing language documentation and to consider how current practices impact relationships and language documentation outcomes.
This came about as a response to a call from linguist Nikolaus Himmelmann to consider how language documentation impacts the way languages are used and how languages interact with each other.
A lot of the reflection to date has been around tools and technologies used in documentation. We thought role-playing would be a good method for workshop participants to reflect upon the behaviours of people involved in language documentation and think about how the documentation process impacts social relationships.
We thought about other game methods like interactive fiction, but we decided to use RPG mainly because it is a good group activity, whereas interactive fiction is an individual activity.
The workshop was run as one part of a workshop day that also included a hands-on session with the Opus speech recognition tool and a session in which people discussed the use of hand puppet technologies for language documentation.
Sounds cool.
Yeah, it was quite a mix of workshop activities.
So who was there?
People came and went during the day. Some really keen people stayed for all three parts. For the RPG session, there were 10 participants. Eight of these people have a background in linguistics and some experience with transcription. Four of the 10 had previously played RPGs.
What level of experience did the participants have?
There was a mix from PhD students to researchers with over 20 years experience who had been involved in language documentation in various ways over their time. You could say that these people had experienced different roles in their personal histories of doing language documentation.
Yes. Others have commented how significant it is to understand the various roles that are involved in language documentation.
Stebbins, Era, and Cousins point out the importance of negotiating roles as a part of working effectively with language communities. So having a good awareness of your role is important when doing this work.
Yes. And I've heard that some people use role-playing as a way to elicit language in documentation activities.
But remind me why we thought that RPG would be a good way to reflect upon language documentation. Why not just ask people what their roles are, like Q&A style, question and answers? Or we could just have done interviews or had surveys.
Yeah, but role-playing is more than just a way of answering questions. It has been used as a method in medical training, for example, to develop communication skills, empathy, and cultural competency. And it is used to develop negotiation skills and consensus building. Most importantly, it is a good way to develop critical thinking skills, creativity, and self-reflection.
So more than just thinking about what people have done, it also develops people's critical thinking skills. Neat.
when it is used like we did in a workshop, role-playing creates a safe place for people to practice negotiating roles in the language documentation process. This is the power of fiction. Participants are invested in the outcome, but the stakes are very low. Their professional reputation and their real-life relationships are not on the line when they explore responses to situations. This method also gives people a chance to take on different perspectives than they might naturally do in real life.
Okay, let's talk about how we did the activity.
And when we talk about the results, you'll hear some great feedback about the process, as well as the insights into language documentation.
How do you create a role-playing game activity?
Well, the two main parts are writing roles for people to take on and scenarios to act out. For this sort of reflection, having realistic roles and scenarios that people can relate to will make it easier for participants to identify with the activity.
And to embellish the roles with their personal experience?
Yes, the roles we wrote represented parts and perspectives of a language documentation process. We had a representative of a funding body, funding Finn, a project manager, CI Charlie, a community liaison, loyal Lou, field workers and research leads, that's research Ray, research assistants, helpful Harry, and archivists, archive Alex. These are all familiar roles in the field language documentation projects.
You'll notice that there's no community member role.
Yeah, at the time of putting the workshop together, we didn't design a community member role. The participants later said that they would not have been comfortable representing a role of a member of a community which they did not belong to. The scenarios which were role-played were designed to be ambiguous in their description of the community, and the community was not specified as being First Nations. They could have been interpreted as an urban community, as a desert community, as a diaspora community of any culture. This was up to the players to negotiate. So was simply not including a community member role the best thing we could do?
Actually, given our backgrounds and the experiences of many of the participants, the scenarios were interpreted as being Indigenous communities in Australia. In this context, by not including Indigenous people in the workshop design and consequently not having community member roles, we have continued the colonial practice of erasure of Indigenous knowledges. Now, reflecting upon the reflection by having conversations with people about the workshop afterwards has highlighted this. Hopefully, our failure to adequately involve First Nations people in the design of this session will provide an opportunity for discussion about better ways to do this.
Yes, some suggestions for the next role-playing game session would be to have participant registration much earlier, which would allow the workshop to acknowledge and integrate the knowledges, experiences, and the cultural backgrounds of participants. Ideally, the first step of this RPG workshop would be to involve participants in the co-design of roles and scenarios. Several participants have already expressed interest in such a collaboration.
We'd like to talk about how to do this better. If you have thoughts about this, please get in touch. And Kathrin, what about the scenarios?
We wrote three scenarios. In the end, we only role-played two due to time constraints. The aim was to provide fictional research scenarios for people to work through while having as much overlap and interaction between the participants as possible. The scenarios were designed to prompt action from participants and trigger their competing interests with the goal of finding an outcome that's acceptable for everyone while maintaining positive relationships.
Scenario one, helpful Harry offered to help out and transcribed several sections of recordings over the long weekend. Unknowingly, helpful Harry was doubling up on work already done by research Ray. They compare their transcriptions and are astonished to find that they differ vastly. Helpful Harry used a different format and metadata, but more importantly, there seem to be major differences within the content of the transcription. Helpful Harry's transcription does not support research Ray's hypothesis about frequent patterns in the data. The task in this scenario was to negotiate which version to keep, or find a way to consolidate the content, while keeping individual goals in mind.
Scenario two, Archive Alex finds audio files of an earlier recording session that had been misplaced. The audio data reveals idiosyncrasies that hadn't been analyzed before. Research Ray is excited, but Lawyer Lou doesn't like the recording because in Lou's opinion, it does not reflect typical speech as spoken by the community. According to Lou's knowledge of the language, the passages in question are plainly wrong, and the speaker would probably never say it that way again. Lou is certain the speaker actually meant to say something else and presses to dismiss the atypical parts of the recording. The task here was to determine what to do about this dilemma.
As is customary in traditional roleplay games, the roles came with various powers, constraints, and bonds.
And individual goals, interests, and responsibilities. Depending on the scenario, there were overlapping goals and strategies among the players. This can lead to scenarios ending in conflict or resolution.
Participants embellished the roles they took on based on their personal knowledge and experiences. One of the participants combined the characteristics and attitudes of three people he knew into the role he had. How did it all play out?
The workshop began with a description of roleplay gaming and an overview of the logistics of what was about to happen. Roles were assigned, and because there were more participants than roles, people who had the same role paired up. People read the role descriptions and then worked on enriching the characteristics.
Oh, and then we described the scenarios.
And then we played.
It actually took a lot longer than we expected. So we only went through two of the three scenarios, and even this ate into the time slot of the following workshop.
Yes. Sorry again, Sarah.
After playing through these scenarios, we had a debrief and discussion. People gave feedback reflecting on both the process of doing this activity and reflecting upon language documentation.
Regarding the process of using role-play gaming as a way of reflecting upon language documentation, people reported that they were able to understand their roles and identify with them and with the challenges faced in the scenario.
Participants found it helpful to take on different perspectives and explore these perspectives in a comfortable space, as one person put it.
Participants found that engaging with language documentation in fictional scenarios and within the mechanics of a role-playing game elicited an emotional reaction, which allowed them to really feel, as one participant said, the impact of their decisions, their actions and behaviors, and it prompted empathy.
One person mentioned that they wished RPG would be used more often in the academic space as a mechanism to facilitate engagement with subject matter.
Several participants admitted that they were initially intimidated by RPG as a discussion format when they read the workshop announcement. One participant recommended changing the title to Empathy Building Scenario rather than calling it role play or game, especially when facilitating the workshop in the academic space. But all participants provided positive and encouraging feedback after engaging in the activity. Even one participant who said they expected it to be dodgy reported they were positively surprised by the process, which they found adds structure compared to a brainstorming process and gives a starting point.
We received a lot of feedback about how to improve the experience.
Some of the key things we learned were that in the future, we would clarify all roles to all participants so that everyone has a better understanding of the capabilities and responsibilities of other roles in the scenarios. Also, participants were keen to work on their roles and embellish them. As we said earlier, role building could be integrated as a deliberate first reflection activity in future workshops. Other suggestions indicated that the participants would have liked more time to get to know the roles. Providing this information prior to the workshop would have helped there.
As well as richer role descriptions, including attitudes and perspectives.
Yes, we could even introduce constraints and attitude cards to help with game flow. These are literally cards that say disagree or focus on the relationship with role X The facilitator hands these out at particular points in the game. They are a way to test how people respond when a scenario goes in a particular direction.
A suggestion was made to base a scenario on the documentation of a hypothetical language or a language like Klingon. This could give more opportunity to set roles for participants across cultures. After the role-playing finished, the group had a discussion about the experience. Some of the topics which emerged in the discussion included
questioning the suitability of Western concepts of ethics for research with people from other ethnicities.
We talked about transcription outcomes, that they are dependent upon research focus as much as external factors like resource and time allocation.
There was conversation around exploitation in research.
This would be great to investigate in more detail with a role play scenario especially designed around this concern.
There were concerns that representatives' views may not adequately reflect the views of an entire community.
There was some discussion around researcher bias and notions of correctness. And a common topic was around the relationships among the roles in the scenarios, that mutual understanding, respect, and trust were important for positive resolution of the scenarios.
These discussion topics didn't go into detail about how language documentation affects the way languages are used. However, they are important insights in the language documentation process, particularly around relationships and research focus.
It sounds great.
Yeah, it really was. More people should try this.
It was a successful way to reflect upon language documentation because the participants were able to draw on prior knowledge and experiences to enrich and embellish their roles.
We knew from studies into using role-playing in medical and educational situations that role-playing is good for developing creative thinking skills. By doing this activity, we learned that role-play does the same in a language documentation context. And in particular, it strengthens empathy with other people's situations and demands in language documentation work.
And it reinforces the importance of negotiating roles and relationships for effective language documentation work. We think it would be a good activity for undergrad linguistics students to do to practice their skills in negotiating roles prior to fieldwork in activities involving participants with experience.
And for you experienced role-play gamers out there, now stones would be falling from the ceiling. The end.
The end.